all things brand new, in Christ Jesus. This represents my takeaway from the sermon of December 24, 2021 by Pastor Joseph Prince of New Creation Church. All scriptures are quoted from the Amplified Bible unless otherwise stated. All brand new. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new.
My love, I'll never find the words, my love, to tell you how I feel, my love. Mere words could not explain. Precious love.
Virgin birth. We wish you a Merry Christmas. Mary conceived baby Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit. The seed came from God and not Joseph, the biological father. The blood that ran through the veins of the blessed baby was from God. It was blood not stained by sin. Mary merely provided nourishment to and carried discharge from the blessed baby in the womb.
The essence of Christmas. The Son of God was made the Son of Man, a human, so that fallen humanity could be redeemed from the slavery of sin and become the beloved children of God. This is the essence of Christmas. This is the reason for celebrating Christmas. He knew no sin. He did no sin. In him was no sin, but we have all sinned. Jesus became sin by receiving our sins. We become right with God by receiving his righteousness. It is a divine exchange. Salvation is a gift. We accept that gift simply by receiving what the Son of God has done on the cross as Jesus the man. Since Jesus took on all of our sins, divine justice demanded that Jesus be punished to the fullest extent of the law. God in his divine capacity as the supreme judge whacked Jesus jilat for our sins. Jesus kana banyak the rook.
What is sin? Sin as a noun is basically a world turned bad by the rejection of God's definition of good and evil. Sin as a verb essentially refers to humanity trying to get out of the ills of the world by our own strength. It has the paradoxical effect of sinking us deeper into the very mire that we are trying to get out. The fallen world. The fallen world is like quicksand. I stumbled upon an explanation of quicksand from Britannica. A patch of apparently solid ground in the jungle that, when stepped on, turns out to have the consistency of cold oatmeal. The unlucky victim starts sinking down into the muck. Struggling only makes it worse. Unless there's a vine to grab a hold of, he or she disappears without a trace. The law was given to show us just how helplessly trapped we are in the quicksand. It was not designed to get us out. The law basically says we should not be in the quicksand in the first place.
I know. I am trying my very best to get out.
But the more I try, the deeper I sink. And the commandment, which was to bring life, I found to bring death. The power to make us sink deeper into the quicksand is our very effort in trying to get out. The law was given to show our need for a vine. Jesus is that vine. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So how did the world become fallen? the choice. You see, God created a perfect world that was defined by His generosity and goodness. God saw everything that He had made, and behold, it was very good, and He validated it completely. Then God handed the perfectly good world to Adam and Eve on a silver platter. And God blessed them, granting them certain authority, and said to them, "Be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth, and subjugate it, putting it under your power, and rule over, dominate, the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and every living thing that moves upon the earth." The Creator and Possessor of the heavens and earth then gave our first progenitors a choice, to trust His definition of good and evil or seize autonomy to redefine good and evil for themselves. The latter is represented by the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. God defines good and evil for the entire cosmos holistically. Humanity defines good and evil based on personal vested interests because we can never see as far and as wide as God does. The deception. Alas! The devil possessed the snake and engaged Eve in snake talk. The devil through the snake beguiled Eve into believing that God was withholding something good from her by not allowing her to eat from the forbidden tree. Consequently, she ate from the forbidden tree and gave some of its fruit to Adam, who also ate. In essence, our first progenitors believed in the devil. Voila! By the rejection of God's definition of good and evil, the world immediately turned bad. The condition would be further aggravated by humanity redefining good and evil under the influence of the devil, who is out to kill, steal, and destroy. Hence, the perfect world that God created became a dog-eat-dog world in which one man's meat is another's poison. Today, the innate propensity of humanity is to believe the ease of the devil to tempt and destroy rather than to trust that God is willing to heal and save. In a nutshell, the root cause of it all is an erroneous perception of God.
Come on. You won't die eating from that tree. God just don't want you to be like Him. God very stingy and selfish one.
It all started with, and is perpetrated by, that wrong perception of God.
He very hard to please one. Like this cannot. Lit it also cannot one. You make one wrong move, you finish. Of the glory.
No. An infinite no. God is nothing like that.
God promised to send the Savior immediately after Eve was beguiled by the devil. And I will put enmity, open hostility, between you and the woman, and between your seed, offspring, and her seed. He shall, fatally, bruise your head, and you shall, only, bruise his heel. The promise was fulfilled by Christ crucified. God sent His Son as Jesus the Nazarene to debunk the devil's lies. Jesus came to reveal God for who He really is.
God is your loving Father who Himself tenderly loves you.
When we know just how much God loves us, we can then trust His definition of good and evil. The promised Savior. God promised to send a Savior in Genesis 3:15 through a virgin birth. He then reaffirmed that promise to Abraham and David. When the appointed time arrived, God fulfilled His promise of the promised Savior through the virgin birth by Mary. Jesus was born. His name means the Lord is salvation and He is Emmanuel, God with us. Both Mary and Joseph descended from the royal line of King David. Therefore, Jesus had a double claim to the throne of Israel as the King of the Jews. The religious leaders of Jesus' day failed to recognize Jesus as the promised Messianic King. Jesus said to them,
"You search the Scriptures, for you believe they give you eternal life, and the Scriptures point to me."
They crucified Him, the King of the Jews, instead. An inscription was placed over the head of Jesus, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." The wisdom of God. Yet, it is in the wisdom of God that Israel would reject the Messiah so that salvation could come to the Gentiles. For God has imprisoned all in disobedience so that He may show mercy to all, Jew and Gentile alike. When the full number of Gentiles have come in, then all Israel will be saved. So where is the occasion to boast of our own obedience? For Romans 11:32 makes it clear that all have been disobedient. We all have been saved only by the obedience of Jesus to die the death of the cross. For this reason, we take every proud thought that sets itself up against the wisdom of God to the obedience of Christ. The reversal. Adam and Eve rejected God's definition of good and evil by seizing the autonomy to redefine them based on their own terms. As an immediate aftermath, they were banished from the perfect settings within the Garden of Eden, into the wilderness, to redefine good and evil. The Son of God took on human flesh as Jesus the Nazarene, to reverse the destruction that came through Adam. His mission was to bring humanity back into the perfect settings within God's kingdom, which is righteousness, peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Adam brought destruction, but Jesus brought salvation. Salvation benefits. The benefits of salvation are found in Psalm 103 2-5. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. How does God satisfy my mouth with good things? All the blessings are found in Christ Jesus as written in the Holy Bible. I just need to agree with what God has written with my amen. We receive those benefits free of charge, but it cost God everything, the hefty price tag. The Son of God came in human form and identified himself with the lowly. This is evident from his birth. He was born into a poor family. When baby Jesus was born, there was no place for the family in the inn, because they had no money to pay for a room. Mary wrapped the blessed baby Jesus in swaddling cloths, and placed him in a feeding trough or manger. A manger resembles a rock-hewn tomb, back in the days of Jesus. Jesus is the bread of life. We are meant to feed on him, the love of God personified. To feed on God's love is to be constantly mindful of his love for us. We let his love play in our heart and mind over and over again.
Mission accomplished. Jesus was on a mission. To die the death of the cross to redeem sinners. He was born to be sacrificed on the cross. The Son of God came in the flesh not to judge the world but to be judged in the likeness of a sinner. Jesus did not come to be served but to serve, to give his life as a ransom for many by paying the price to set them free from the penalty of sin. He did not come to exact punishment but to be punished. The just and righteous for the unjust and unrighteous, the innocent for the guilty. To freely bestow the benefits of salvation on sinners, the Son of God had to die the most shameful and humiliating death of his day. Power over death. No one could kill Jesus before his appointed time to be crucified. On one occasion, the people of Israel tried to throw Jesus off a cliff. In another instance, they tried to stone him with rocks. Both times, Jesus just passed through the crowd unharmed. But when the time for him to be glorified on the cross, he allowed himself to be crucified. When Jesus identified himself to the arresting soldiers by saying, "I am," they whole jingbang fell backwards. Such was his majestic aura. Jesus was not murdered. No one had the power to take his life from him. He allowed himself to die. When divine justice had been fully satisfied in him crucified, he emphatically announced with a victory cry, "It is finished." Thereafter, Jesus gave permission to his spirit to be dismissed.
I want to break free. I want to break free. I want to break free from your lies. You're so self-satisfied, I don't need you.
The Rapture. By his death, burial, and resurrection, Jesus has conquered all forms of lack. The Lord is my shepherd and I shall not lack. The last enemy to be defeated is death, through the rapture. From now till then, there will be signs of wars and disturbances like civil unrest, revolts, and uprisings, as well as violent earthquakes, famines, and deadly and devastating pestilences of plagues and epidemics. But the end will not come immediately. While believers are protected from all those calamities, we will face persecutions. When we accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, we are effectively trusting his definition of good and evil. It is on that basis that we do not seek revenge, because the perfectly just God will vindicate us. Whatever is meant as evil for us, God will turn it for our good. We are citizens of God's kingdom, but we live in a world that is redefining good and evil based on its own terms. Persecution is therefore inevitable. Believers will be persecuted by the system of the world, the Babylonian system that is in direct contrast with the value system of God's kingdom. For this reason, Jesus said that believers will definitely encounter troubles and tribulations. But we take courage in the truth that Jesus has conquered the world. Although we are in the world, we are not of the world. Noah felt the turbulences whilst in the ark, but he was not destroyed by them. We may feel the turmoil of the world that is spinning wildly out of control, but will be unscathed because we are in Christ. Jesus will deliver us from, and in, the troubles of fire and flood. This ties back to the sermons on 12th of December and December 19th, 2021. Respectively, the armor of God, and look up. Don't give up. Thanksgiving. You have spent hours cooking a good meal for your loved ones. When do you feel appreciated for your efforts? It is when they ask for more of your cooking. In the same way, how can we thank God for His precious blessings? It is by taking more blessings from Him. Jesus was hungry in the natural when He ministered to the adulterous woman at the well. When she received salvation from Him, Jesus was rejuvenated. He told His disciples that His food was to do the will of God the Father and to finish His work. Jesus is delighted when we constantly and continually take from Him. God the Father knows we have need for the things of the world. Take from Him, for it is His good pleasure to give.
There is no need to scheme and connive. Ask God and ask big. We can boldly approach the throne of grace for anything, all because Christ crucified has made us brand new creations in Him.
Grazie. Deti svuoti ev da bowed from the sermon of 24 December 2021 by Pastor Joseph Prince of New Creation Church. Please visit the website for the official sermon notes. This initiative is not endorsed by NCC or Pastor Prince. It is my way of ingesting the sermon. Till we meet again.
Hai kamsina, mhai magea.